So this is part three of week eight. We're just going to do a little in-class lab to practice what we've covered with functions and just to get some practice, with them. So I've just got a workspace here called week eight functions guest list. I'm opening up the main.cpp and we're going to do using namespace std. You guys can follow along if you want, or you can just let me type and then just tell me what you think we should do. But here is our lab. So let me know if it's too small. I can try to make it a bit bigger. But in this exercise, we're going to create a program that will be used to print the guest list to an event and then clear the guest list when the event is over. Begin by completing function prototypes for print guest list, clear guest list, which are both going to be passing three string variables. Don't worry about them being reference variables. We'll do that after. Ensure that the variables cannot be modified with the print guest list function by using the keyword const in the parameter list. Okay, so we don't want them to be able to be modified once they're made. Now that the function prototypes have been declared, at the bottom of the file, define both functions. Okay. So what are we going to start with, guys? What do we think? So we've got our int main, so we're going to make our functions. We're going to declare them outside of this. We want to have a function called print guest list and clear guest list. Okay, so print guest list and clear guest list, that's going to be the names of them. And they're both going to have three parameters that they're or arguments that they're passed. And are they going to return anything? We could return something from the clear guest list if we wanted to, or from the print guest list if we wanted to have like a success message, but no, we're not going to return anything. So we'll do void print. There we go, Simon. Nice guest list. Okay, and then it said something about having three arguments. Okay, so having three arguments of type string. So we know it's going to be a string, in which case I'm going to have to include, I believe I might be forgetting it here, but it might be C string. Is it C string or string? I think it's just this. Okay. So we want three strings. So we'll have string, I believe, was it name one, name two, name three? What do they want? Guest one, guest two, guest three. Okay. So guest one, string, guest underscore two, and string, guest underscore three. Okay. So that's going to be our arguments that are passed. Okay. Nice. You got it, Simon. Perfect. Okay. And then inside of these curly braces is going to be our actual logic for the print guest list function. Okay. And basically here, what do we want to do? We're not going to return anything, so we don't want to return anything. But yeah, you got it. We want to see out to the console guest underscore one. And we might actually be able to do a little bit of, formatting here. Guest one. And then as I do this, and then we'll just change this to two, three, two, three. All right. And then we'll just add an end line to each of these. Perfect. Okay, yeah, exactly what you said, Simon. Okay, so that's our print guest list function. Now, what's the next function we want to make here? Let's take a look at it. We want to do something called clear guest list. How would we do clear guest list? What do you guys think? System CLS. Not sure what you mean by that. CLS? What do you mean by that, Simon? CL system CLS. If we take a look here, the print guess list function are go both going to be passed string arguments, guess one, guess two, guess three, which have all been provided. So basically, what we're going to do is this. string G1. Yes, Ben. String G2. Mark. String G3. Simon. So they're already going to be provided at the beginning of the program. Clear command line. Oh, I see. You want to actually just use like a pre-made function for that. So if we read the instructions here a little bit clearer, Simon, I think what you'll see. So the print guess list function should print the guess list in the order of guess one, guess two, guess three, which will, with each entry being printed on a new line for testing purposes. Please ensure that the new line is printed after guess three, either through the end L or new line character. Then the clear guess list function should replace the string values contained with guess one, guess two, and guess three with the string value. A single space. So I don't think we want to use CLS here. What we want to do is we want to replace them with a single space. So what we can actually do, same thing as what we did before, but we're going to make the function called clear guest list. We're going to change the name. And it's going to take three arguments as well. It's going to take an argument called guest one. Well, actually, no, it won't. Will it? String guest two. I guess it depends how we want to do it. String guest three. And then what we want to do is we want to set those variables basically to nothing. So map. Not sure what you mean by map, Simon. What we want to do is set guest one equal to one space, guest two equal to one space, and guest three equal to one space. Right? And that's pretty much all we want to do with that. We can say C out guest list cleared or something like that, but. Now, from the function body of main, make the following function calls. So, print the guest list, clear the guest list, print the guest list, right? So, basically, we've got our names here, and now we want to call the print. And as I start typing, you can see, look, it knows it's a function, has the F here, print guest list, and it knows that it's expecting an int, int, guess one, guess two, guess three. Well, that's wrong. It's not actually expecting an int. So, maybe I did my string declaration wrong. But I don't think I did. So we're going to pass it G1, G2, and G3. And then we're going to call the clear guest list function. And we're going to pass it G1, G2, and G3. And then we're going to call the print guest list function again, G1, G2, G3. All right. So what's happening here? Is basically the code that I wrote in print guest list is going to get run on line 28 and line 32. But in between them, the code on line 14 to 17, it's going to set those guests to being empty. Now, this won't actually work yet because we're not using references. And I'm going to explain what references are. I'll run this and you'll see that it won't actually clear anything because. It's just going to be changing whatever local variable I have here as my argument, but it's not actually going to be changing the G1, right? That was what was passed in, and it was changed to a space here as guest three variable, but it won't actually change the G1 because it's just a copy of what we've created. It's not an actual reference or pointer to that specific data. It's just a copy of it in the system. Okay, so we call those passing guest one, guest two, guest three with each function call. All right, so let's run this and see what happens. Oh, guest one was not declared in the scope. Oh, did I spell them wrong? Yeah, guest underscore one. Whoops. Now they know their strings because I saved it. Perfect. So look, we can see it printed guest one, guest two, guest three, Ben, Mark, Simon. And then we called the clear guest list function on line 30. Nothing got cleared like I was expecting because we're not using references yet. And then printed guest one, guest two, guest three again because they weren't actually cleared. So let's take a look. We're going to take a pause from this just for a second, and we're going to go back into the PowerPoint and we're going to talk about reference variables and how reference variables work. So, what is a reference variable? Well, basically, let's take a look at this. We've got a double called P1 and a double called P2. P1 is equal to 54.50, and the P2 is now equal to P1. What P2 will do is actually store a copy of 54.5. So that's what's happening, right? We're storing a copy of it. We're not actually changing the specific value in memory. So P2 creates a copy of P1, and then we print P1, and it's going to now equal 57.5. We change the value to equal 57.5. So now, if we use a reference variable, the reference variable will actually reference the value stored by P1. So the way we declare a reference variable is we include the ampersand symbol here. So shift 7 after the variable type that you're creating. And then you set it to the variable that you want it to reference the value of, not the copy. So now in this example, we set P1 to 54.5. And then we set a reference variable of P2 to equal the value stored by P1. And then we set P1 to equal 57.5. In this example, P2 would now equal 57.5 because we changed P1 to equal 57.5. In the first example, we changed P1 to equal 57.5, but P2 would still equal 54.5. It would just have that copy. Right? Another way to declare a reference variable is just right off the bat, kind of like what Milo was suggesting earlier, where you combine the code all in one line. You just do double P2 equals P1, and it will reference the value stored by P1. So how do they work? Well, let's look at this. Here's a little bit of code in a function that uses a value parameter and that uses a reference parameter. So we can see they're passing an argument called price of type double. In the first example, it's just going to have a copy of price. So price equals price times 1.1. So what this is going to do is it's not going to change the price in the calling code. It's only going to change the price for the local variable within the brackets or scope of the increase underscore price function. Then when we return it, it's going to return the changed price to the calling code. Okay, so you actually have to use a return function to pass the changed variable here. Because it's just a value parameter. This is just going to copy what was passed into it, make a copy of it, but it won't actually change it in memory. We now have this copy of it, and we have to kind of mail it back or send it back to the function that called it so that we can return it and then use the copied, changed version, right? So say we passed in 5 when we call the increase price function. And then it makes a copy of 5 and times it by 1.1. So now we have this variable called price that equals 5.5 because we just multiplied it. Then we return the copy 5.5, and then we will replace the actual 5 with our copy of 5.5. Now, the difference when we use a reference parameter with the ampersand symbol is you don't have to use a return function. It actually changes the code or the value in the calling code. So it actually changes, it doesn't make a copy. It actually references the value in memory stored and changes it in the calling code. So, for example, let's say we are passing a reference parameter to price. is that price, there's only one of them now, we're not making a copy, and it's equal to 5. Okay. Then we set that reference parameter to times it by 1.1. It actually changes it in the calling code way over here. Even though we're in this function, it's changing it to 5.5 back there at the same time. And then we don't have to return it. It's already changed. So when we go back to print it, it's the updated version. If you want to call a function with a reference parameter, then you don't actually need to set an assignment to it because we're not returning anything. It's changed automatically. Whereas normally with a value parameter where it makes a copy of the value, we'd have to, just like here, we'd have to return price. And then once it's returned, we'd have to set it to a new variable or the copy of it, so that we get the updated price of times 1.1. Whereas here, we just call it and pass the value, and it's changed. It's all changed in one spot. It keeps it very simple. Okay, so let's take a look back in our code at creating reference parameters or reference variables, because that's what this is asking for. Three string reference variables. Ensure that the variables cannot be modified by using the word const in the parameter list. So we didn't do that either. So we should probably do that as well. So we should do const string ampersand, right? Const string ampersand. So we're going to add these. And what this is going to do is it's going to allow, when I set guest one equal to this, it'll actually change this, because it's going to be a reference variable to that, right? So let's see. Might not be doing this correctly here, just because. There we go. All right, let's give that a try. Oh, I gotta close the old version. Okay. No match for this operator. Oh, because I made it a const. Yes. Well, when we're clearing it, we won't make them consts. There we go. So see how that worked? It actually cleared it on the second time printing it through, because we made them reference variables. It wouldn't let me actually change them with the const values because a const can't change. So I just removed the const keyword there. But when we're printing it, we want them not to be able to change. So, okay, we'll walk through this a little bit slower. I've got three variables, Ben, Mark, and Simon, and they're strings. Okay. And then I'm calling this print guest list G1, G2, G3. So I'm passing Ben, Mark, and Simon into that function. Okay, so inside the print guest list function, I'm going to get Ben, Mark, and Simon. But because I added the ampersand here, it's actually going to be a reference variable, which means it's not going to create a copy of Ben, Mark, Simon. It's actually going to reference the point in memory of Ben, Mark, and Simon. Okay, so here we're just printing it. So we just printed Ben, Mark, and Simon because of the values. They never changed their consts here. That's pretty straightforward. Okay, so making them reference variables here doesn't really impact any of the logic or the functionality of that function. But when I call the clear guest list on line 30 and I pass Ben, Mark, Simon, okay, because I made them a reference variable to Ben, Mark, and Simon, so it's actually referencing the value. It's not making a copy and referencing that. It's referencing the value of Ben, Mark, and Simon. When I set guest underscore one to equal a space and guest underscore two and guest underscore three to equal a space, it is now setting the value of Ben, Mark, Simon, which is referencing to a space. It's not changing the copy of them to a space. It's changing them to a space. And then when we go obviously and print them back, G1, G2, G3, then we're going to get nothing because they were actually changed in memory. Does that make sense? I know it can be a little bit confusing with references and reference variables, but that is how we use reference variables. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense to you guys? Any questions about that stuff? You guys still processing it? You guys are quiet today. Yes. All right, so we've had a couple ideas here. We just paused there. So you're wondering if we add C out under the clear guest function here and then get rid of the ampersand symbol like this. Okay, so do you want me to copy what I basically had here, I'm assuming. Right. And then you want, yes, okay, you are right. But then what will happen if I get rid of the ampersand symbol like you're suggesting? Okay, this is fine. And this will reset the copy to be empty and print out an empty version. But then when we call the print guest list function again, we're going to be passing it Ben, Mark, and Simon. Right, and then they're going to be printed again, and so the list is actually still existing. You know what I mean? Oh, that's what you're wanting to happen. Oh, I see. Oh, I see. Okay, yeah, if you wanted to keep the list, but in this example, this is saying like the event happens, you have the list, and then the event's over, and once the event's over, you want to actually clear that list, but you actually want to clear the list. You don't actually want to save it still somewhere because here it's still existing. If we actually make them reference variables, it's actually changing this variable to be empty again. So it's actually resetting it, which is what the instructions were kind of wanting. Okay, everything's crystal clear. So that is what you're wanting. So you were just wondering if there's a way for us to clear the guest list temporarily, but then still print the guest list with the original names. I see. Yeah. So then that is what would happen if we did this. You've got it exactly. However, with the instructions for this lab, what they were wondering was we actually want to permanently, we actually want to permanently. So if I print this again, you'll see it will print it 3 times and the last two will be empty. We want to permanently erase that list. So here I printed from the clear guest list function here on lines 19 to 21. But then this was actually called from the print guest list function, and they were actually passed the G1, G2, G3 values, and they were empty. Yeah, you got it. Perfect. And then even if I came down here and I went like test, and then I did G1, G2, G3, right? If I print these, though the test, oh, whoops. What did I do? The test print will actually be empty itself as well, right? So where I printed test here, there's my spaces. Now if I print test, if I copy this, yeah, that's the power of the reference variables if you want to actually change it in memory. So like I was saying, a really useful place to use this would be if you had vectors or something and you didn't want to make a giant copy of a huge vector. So we can see here my test, Ben, Mark, Simon, printed from line 32, then our print method, then our clear method cleared them, then it cleared them for the print method, and then even in our second test, they're actually empty. So it can be useful if you don't have to return stuff or make copies all over the place. Cool. So that's references. Another time we'll cover header files, and you know, we covered functions today and creating functions. But actually creating a header file and then including like your own custom. So here we created a temperature.h file, and inside that temperature.h file, we have these functions 2 Celsius and 2 Fahrenheit. And then we can actually use those functions as if they were coming from something like how we use our standard library at the top of this one, or like the string library, right? You're including that header file, and it's like including another class with a bunch of different functions in it. Right. So in Java, if you wanted to save a copy, you'd make a brand new variable to keep it, then clear the old one. Right. Yes. And you can still do that in C++. We're just talking about if you actually want to change the original version, you can actually change the original version without having to pass a copy, make a copy, change the original, change the copy, and do all of that work around. This you can just boom, just like that, add the ampersand symbol. And it's basically like you're working with the original variable and only the original variable itself. And where you change one, it changes it everywhere, right? So it's kind of helpful to know that you can do that. It saves you a lot of code. Let me see. Another little tidbit of cool information. So you can make your own namespace structures like this. So here we've declared a namespace and called it temperature. And then inside of it, we've created two functions, so two Celsius and a two Fahrenheit. And you know how at the top of our thing in CodeLight here, we have using namespace STD? Well, you could now do using namespace temperature to use that namespace. So here we've got using namespace temperature. And then inside of your int main, you can just call the two Celsius function just like that, even though it's in a different namespace. And we've also included our temperature.header file. So any of the functions that are actually in the header file, let me see. This is our header file. We've declared two functions inside our header file. So the way they do it is they have an if not defined guard, and then they define the header file, they declare the functions, so what they expect, and then end the include guard. Then the implementation file named temperature.cpp that goes along with temperature.h or the .header file actually has the defined function logic in it for those two functions, two Celsius and two Fahrenheit. And then the main.cpp file, we actually include that header file, and then we can use the namespace to reference those. If they're in a namespace, that is, you can use the namespace to reference them. If they're not in a namespace, you can just call the functions because they're inside that header file there. But if they are in a namespace like this, then you have to do using namespace temperature. Otherwise, you'd have to call them like this, temperature colon colon with the scope selector, and then call the two Celsius. Cool. Here's another example of a header file. So you have your if not defined, define it, include whatever preprocessor directives you need, and then they've put their space in a namespace called console. They've created a couple functions here, declared them. And then in the CPP file, they actually define them with the logic in those functions. A bunch of code going on here. And then when they call it, they just include the console.h file, and it gives them access to all of those functions. Critical test phases. So we want to test it with valid input data and make sure the results are correct, but also with invalid data. So how I might do that, exactly what you might think if I just run this, control F5. Now I already ran this with, 350, so I'm getting 6 miles per gallon. But now if I run it with, what if I write 300? It doesn't like that, right? It just gave me a zero. And then it just exited the program. So maybe we want to be able to catch that error and be like, hey, enter an actual number, not a string. All right, so that's testing with invalid data. So to make testing easier, it's always the best thing if you can come up with a testing plan. So you want to make sure that you're going to list the valid entries that you're going to make and the correct results for them, and then make sure that they're actually correct when you test it. So write it down, use a calculator, and then check it to see if it's actually the right number. Then write down the invalid entries you're going to make, and then show what should happen. Or the limits that the test should allow for. Sometimes you want to test, make sure you test a wide enough range. So what if a user enters, a billion? That's still a number, but it's way too big. Or a negative number or something like that. Or not knowing what the results of each set of entries should be and assuming that the answers are correct because they look correct, right? So what if my numbers are actually dividing? What if 30 divided by 10 gives me like 4, but it should be 3? Something else that you can do, now I won't do this, but something really good for testing for you guys is to see out all of the variables as you go through your program. So we can see here, they go and they print 36 months at a time with an investment and interest rate of $100 at 3%. Over 3 years, that's 36 months. And we can see they loop through and actually print for each month, month one, month two, month three, and they print the variable future value. Now, through testing, they do this. But then once you actually make sure that that's the right value you're expecting, then on the correct console, you get rid of all of those test prints, and then you just print out the last month, obviously, of 3662. But in order to test that each month is correct, you want to print them out each one by one. And yeah, it can be painstakingly slow or whatever, but it's always a good procedure to test as you go, or do print test print statements and stuff. And I'm sure you guys did those in Java all the time. Print your variables as you go so you can see them and see what's happening, see when they change, see what's changing them or what they're changing to, and why the errors are occurring. Another way to do this is with breakpoints. And that way you don't have to actually print them all out all at once. You can just view them by hovering your mouse over the variable. So in Visual Studio, a breakpoint looks like this. A debugging session looks like this. If you have the debug window open, and you can see the variable and the value for what it currently is in the for loop. So we can see I is at number 5, the fifth iteration through the loop. And then we can see the variable as we loop through for the fifth time. Same example in Xcode right there with a breakpoint. So we're going to try to do this with Code Lite here. We're going to go and set a breakpoint. You have to right click. So if I want to do, where do I want to put it? Where I'm doing my math here on miles per gallon, and I'm dividing it, right? Let's pretend